We are now into our next case, and this case is a bit different from the cases we have seen in the earlier, which is the FabMart case and the Ace Gears case. It says that we are going to now look at recruitment into an organization. How do we fill the staff in an organization? So we will see in this case basically that unlike the numerical values and plotting of numerical values we saw in the previous cases, data tends to be a bit more unstructured. If you have looked at resumes and so on, you will notice basically that data in the resume is not numerical, right? It's anything but numerical. And so we have to deal with those kinds of things and figure out how to select candidates based on information that is in the resume. So much more subjective, let's say, or much more qualitative kinds of information we will see. Yeah, Milan, I think that's basically the difference in this case.
That is correct, GV. And we did actually see in the ASCARES case that one of the things that came out of their production planning schedule was the manpower requirement sort of sheet, right? And that is a logical connection, I think, to the conversation that we are going to have this week.
Yeah, correct. Yes. And for this case, we are very fortunate to have with us a professional from the HR industry. She's been in HR for decades. Varsha Gande. Varsha, maybe you can introduce yourself and maybe explain to the students what you have done. Currently, you're with Mercer, or last few years you've been with Mercer.
Yes, yeah. So last few years I have been with Mercer, and you're right, I do have decades of experience. I have more than 20 years of experience in HR. And when we say we have experience in HR, what does that mean? It basically means that I have worked on processes for organizations, and that could be anywhere from setting up the salary pay ranges, for example, who should get paid how much, to designing engagement surveys, to ensuring that people have a smooth exit either when they retire or they resign, for example. So all of those processes I've been looking at. Last few years I have been with Mercer Consulting, the last 5 years, and Mercer Consulting is a consulting organization, HR consulting organization, that's part of a global conglomerate called Marsh McLellan. Mercer helps organizations review and redefine their processes, sometimes put into place, completely new processes on how they will handle employees. Mercer has about 18,000 employees worldwide. In India, Mercer is the largest consulting organization and has expertise across all these areas that I had just mentioned to you.
Okay. So, I think then maybe with that introduction, maybe Varsha, you can take us through the specific case that we have, which is from a IT industry, right? It's an IT case.
That's
and,
right.
Yeah, and maybe we can discuss the case.
Sure.
So, GV, as we discussed with Varsha, I think the objective of this week is really to understand what are the different steps involved in the recruitment process. But more importantly, how can we use data to understand where recruitment is working well, where it is not working well, what challenges are there, and so on and so forth. So I'm sure Varsha will be able to tell us a lot in terms of how exactly the recruitment process works and what kind of data does the recruitment process throw up. So Varsha, maybe you can begin by telling us, what exactly is manpower planning?
Sure, Milan. So let's start off with what really happens when an organization starts planning for the next year. So when you're planning for the next year, it's true of all organizations. You could have large-sized organizations like your Accentures, Infosys, Wipro, and you can have small-sized startups that we have, whether it's a Dunzo or a Swiggy, and I'll just name a few companies here. One of the things that they do is they start looking at what is going to be their business plan for the next year. Based on their business plan, they decide saying that, okay, these are the kind of people, these many employees we need to be able to deliver results from a business perspective. So I need 50 salespeople in my organization to get me a revenue of 100 crores. And that, very simply put, is called manpower planning. Manpower planning is basically making sure that you have the right number of people in your organization. You have hired them at the right time, very important. So for example, if the Hawaii slippers, the season that they sell most is during the monsoons. So if you don't have your salespeople during the monsoon, you have missed out a large part of your business cycle. So you have to make sure that your hiring is already done by the monsoon begin, and make sure that this sales team is well organized or well trained to be able to deliver the kind of performance. That in a nutshell is called manpower planning. Who will we hire? How many people will we hire? What will they do? And what do they need to make sure that they are performing for the organization is manpower planning.
So this is very similar, Milan, to what we saw in the previous case, right?
Production
manpower plan that came out, yeah.
Yes.
From the automotive case, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yes. As we decided to manufacture, 100 gear setup, we realized that we needed X number of people, right, to produce Y number of gears. Correct. And that is really the manpower plan, I think, that Varsha is referring to here.
That's right. And one of the most important processes in manpower planning is recruitment. Now, even if you have a very small organization, and we've seen this in startups also, all startups are, it's very, very important for them to make sure that, there is one person who can go and hire the kind of talent, or what we call employees, required for the organization. So that becomes one of your first roles, one of the first positions that any organization requires. And the recruitment process consists of this person saying, okay, I have these many vacancies in my organization. This is what I need for these vacancies. So there's a specific position, there's a specific job, and I need to find people who can actually do this role, who can solve the problems, who can take decisions at that particular level. So it's the complete hiring process. Recruitment starts with hiring and goes right on to when a person gets into the company. We call it onboarding, and make sure that the person has started performing in the organization. So this entirety is the recruitment process.
So, Varsha, maybe you want to tell us a little bit more in detail about how this manpower planning works, because this is something, we saw in the last case as well, and clearly seems to be a very important important piece of how planning is done every year.
Yes, Milan, so that's absolutely right. If you don't have a human resource plan, right? So that's it's basically like having a blueprint of what is it that the organization will deliver. If you have a big IT services company, you need to say that, okay, this IT services company is going to get $500 million in revenue, needs so many people to be able to actually deliver that revenue. And this is why we look at a human resource plan. The human resource plan not only talks about how many people will you need, but what is it that they will be doing? What will be the levels, or what will be the grades that they will be? So you would typically have heard of designations like software engineer, senior software engineer, team leader, or a project leader. What does that really mean? It indicates the kind of work that a person is supposed to be doing in that organization. So a project leader can take some decisions that maybe a software engineer or a team member cannot. Right? And this forms the complete basis of the human resource plan. How many people?
And also, presumably, you will decide what compensation they should get.
Exactly. So how many people at what level? Your level also indicates what is the kind of salary that you will be giving at that level. So obviously, a software engineer will earn much lesser than a project leader. Typically, a CEO of an organization earns 200 times what a software engineer earns, right, as a fresher. This is just, I'm just sharing the gap that is there in salaries. And that is decided through the basis of a human resource plan, saying, okay, these decisions are much more important to the organization, so we'll have to pay them more. These decisions, a lot of mistakes can happen. It's easily replaceable, so we'll pay them less. So that is how you help plan the labor cost too. Sorry, Milan. Yeah.
So at the heart of this, it seems to me, Varsha and Giri, the core insight is that you cannot take out one person and just casually replace him with another person. I think what I'm hearing you say, Varsha, is that, you know, there are certain skills that each individual has that are relevant to the job that he or she is doing. And so if person X leaves, you cannot simply replace person X with person Y. You have to see that there is some amount of matching that is going on between what person X used to do, what skills a person X had, and what his replacement or her replacement brings to the table.
So more increasingly, the jobs are getting specialized. Is that how I understand? I mean, so there's much more specialization in the jobs, especially IT is very, very specialized in that sense.
Yes.
And so this replacement becomes much more complicated because you have to look at the specialized skills that they have.
Absolutely. Yes. So you have to make sure that the person that you're getting into the organization is an absolute fit for the role. Absolute fit. He's able to do what is required, you know, either in the project or in the product development, as you talk about it, but you have to have those skills. And as you said, GV, in IT, that becomes very, very important. There is an inventory of skills that most IT companies have. And obviously, some skills always have a premium. It becomes very important for you to have the most important, you know, a good combination of these skills. And that's how people get hired, especially in the IT sector.
Yeah. All right. And even in the production planning case, GV, we saw that the people who could operate the hubbing machine could not operate the other machine, right? So you could not replace them very easily.
Yeah. It's not one to one. Yeah, that's true.
It's not one to one.